Baptist. In preparing for this homily, I have to tell you, it really made me appreciate what a remarkable man he really was. Now, when I think of John the Baptist, try to visualize him. I, like many of you may, I picture him as just a big, burly guy, just a big man.
Kind of like Father James.
Harley. He's a character that's larger than life. A man who could wrestle a bear and probably win. I picture him in between baptisms, standing in the river, and then just looking down, reaching out and catching a fish with his bare hands. I mean, he's that kind of guy. To me, he's kind of a man's man. Big, strong, dressed in animal skins, with a big leather manly belt wrapped around him. Very wild, unkempt hair and a beard. The kind of man that would draw me to come sit by a campfire with him and eat locusts and wild honey. Why not? Anything tastes good with honey on it. He is the kind of man you would always want at your side. A man you know would always have your back. Now, when I visualize John, sometimes you may, in that description, think of him as having very dark, intense, maybe unsettling eyes. I think completely the opposite. I think John the Baptist probably had the most gentle eyes of any man of his time. Eyes that had a constant twinkle of joy in them. Eyes that would make you believe John would and could bear hug the whole world. He had that twinkle of joy because God gifted John the Baptist with a foreknowledge of the coming of the Messiah. First chapter in the book of St. Luke, verses 39 through 41. And Mary arose in those days and went into the hill country with haste into the city of Judah and entered into the house of Zacharias and saluted Elizabeth. And it came to pass that when Elizabeth heard the salutation of Mary, the babe leaped in her womb and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost. Even before he was born, John knew the coming of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, did he realize it as a young child? I don't know. But imagine when he came to the age of understanding, the joy and gentleness that filled his heart, by not only knowing, but also being commanded by God to prepare the way, to bear witness for a Messiah that would change the whole world. Our gospel reading today testifies to the character of John the Baptist, a character that was also larger than life. The Pharisees wanted to get to the bottom of who this John the Baptist really was. Who was this man who was garnishing such a large following, preaching a message of repentance and baptizing people by the droves? Now, it's not clearly implied, but I believe this was a bit of a test for John. He's carrying a heavy load. He's doing a lot of heavy lifting. He's baptizing as he was commanded. He's preaching as he was commanded. He's working really hard. So these men from the Pharisees come and they ask him, "Who art thou?" And he confessed and denied not, but confessed, "I am not the Christ." They ask him, "Are you Elias? Are you that prophet?" That question to me is the real test. John easily could have said, "Well, yes, yes I am." That would have been the easy path for John. No more carrying a heavy load. No more heavy lifting. It would have been the path that led him to power and fame, even wealth. Now, we've all heard of WWJD, what would Jesus do? Well, I think we should also ask WWJTBD, what would John the Baptist do? When our character is tested, when we are tempted by the easy path, we must ask ourselves, what would John the Baptist do? John's character could not be tempted. He would not stray from the hard path God had sent him into the world to walk. Then, the men of the Pharisees asked him, "Well, who are you then? If you're not the Christ or that prophet, who are you? And why are you baptized?" He explains by quoting from Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3. In verse 23 of today's gospel, John pretty much sums up who he is and the path he is on. He said, "I am the voice crying in the wilderness. Make straight the way of the Lord, as said the prophet Isaiah." He was the voice that preached and baptized the people in water as a profession of repentance and an outward sign of the spiritual blessings to come from the Messiah. The Messiah that is now among them, the Messiah that he is not even worthy enough to do the lowliest task of a slave, unlatch his shoe. Now, verse 28 kind of puzzled me at first. These things were done in Bethabara beyond Jordan, where John was baptizing. And it kind of puzzled me because I was like, why is John making such a point of where this took place? I did some digging and talk about historical disagreement. Many have concluded that it was actually Bethany, which was a short distance from Jerusalem. But then there were those that argued it couldn't be Bethany, because there was no river or ford in Bethany, just a large spring. It had to be this place here or that place there. I came to the conclusion that I believe part of John's reason for writing verse 28 is simply that he wanted to make the point it was a public place. Where there was a ford and a river back then, there would have been a town or a village, probably a large village with lots of people. John was not preaching or baptizing in secret or in the shadows. He was fulfilling his destiny by witnessing before the whole world the coming of the Messiah. He was making way, blazing the path for the Son of God. We are Christians, little Christs, but I think we all are in some way John the Baptists. We too have been gifted with the foreknowledge of the return of the Messiah. We too have been commanded to make way for his return, to witness to the glory to the world of our Lord and Savior Christ. We know we are not worthy to unlatch his shoe or to gather up the crumbs under his table. Dearly beloved, the joy of Christmas is upon us. It is a time that we have been preparing for this Advent season with reflection and self-evaluation, a time of family and friends, a time to celebrate the birth of our Savior, a time of joy and thanksgiving for all the blessings God has bestowed upon us, a time of laughter and fellowship, and the gifts aren't too bad either. But it can also be, for so many, a time of loneliness and despair. So many feel lost, even forsaken, during the Christmas season. So what would John the Baptist do? There is an artist by the name of David Gray. He is kind of a mix between folk music and alternative rock. He's very, very talented. And he wrote a song titled Fugitive. Part of the refrain in this song goes like this. If only for a second I see a twinkling in your eye, I've got to try. Let us be John the Baptist, especially this Christmas. Let us be a voice that cries out in the wilderness of despair and loneliness. Let us make way a path for those who feel forsaken with love, prayer, and compassion. Let the true joy of Christmas shine in our eyes. So maybe, just maybe, we can, even if it's just for a second, see that same joy twinkle in the eyes of those who need it most. Dearly beloved, let us always try to be John the Baptist. Let us always try to bear hug the whole world. Amen.
Amen.
Remember the words of our Lord Jesus, who said, it is more blessed to give than to receive.